Hello students. So students, in the previous two sessions we started with a new chapter, chapter number 4th, Kingdom Animalia. So in the previous sessions we have studied about the criteria that are used for the classification of animals, and then we moved on to studying the phylums. So we have studied about some of the phylums that are included in this kingdom. The first phylum that we studied was Porifera, then it was Cnidaria, Ctenophora, Platyhelminths, Askhelminths, Annelida, Arthropoda, and then we studied about Mollusca and Echinodermata. So these are the phylums that we studied in the previous two sessions. Now in this session we are going to study about the remaining phylums, and then we'll try and complete this chapter. So the phylum that we are going to study in today's session is Hemichordata. So hemi means half and chordata is rod. Okay, and the examples that are being put into this phylum is Balanoglossus and Sacoglossus. So these are the two examples. This is Balanoglossus and this is Sacoglossus. Now earlier this phylum, it was considered to be a subphylum of Chordata. Okay, because of the buccal diverticulum, which was considered as a notochord. Okay, what is a notochord? Notochord is a column, a cartilaginous column that is present in some of the organisms. In detail about notochord we'll be studying in the next slides, but now this particular phylum, it is being separated and it is placed as a separate phylum of non-chordata. Okay, so these are exclusively marine animals. So the animals which are included in phylum Hemichordata, these are exclusively found in marine, and they live on the bottom of the sea. Okay, they literally burrow the sea beds, and you will be seeing these animals at the bottom of the sea beds. Now mostly these are free living, but some of the animals like Rhabdopleura are sedentary. So this is Rhabdopleura that you will find sedentary. It is completely non-active. It just remains at one place. The body of these organism, it is soft, it is vermiform, unsegmented. So you will see that there are no segments present on the body of the organism, and it is divided into three parts: the proboscis, the collar, and the trunk. The alimentary canal, it is complete, and it is straight or U in shape. The respiration, it occurs through numerous gills which are present, and the gills are opened by gill slits. Circulatory system over here is an open type of a circulatory system, and excretion, it occurs with the help of glomerulus. Nervous tissue is embedded in the epidermis on both the dorsal and the ventral sides, and the sexes of this particular organism, they are separate. So the sexes are separate. Sometimes there are certain organisms where they are bisexual, so at that case of course the sexes are not separate, but mostly the sexes are separate. Fertilization, as I said that the sexes are separate, so the fertilization that takes place, it is external, and the development is indirect through free swimming larva. Okay, so it is an external fertilization where the development of the organism's body, it takes place through a free swimming larva. Now this phylum, it is a connecting link between the non-chordata and the chordata. Okay, now next is the phylum Chordata. Chordata, it is characterized by the presence of cartilaginous notochord. Okay, so here there is a presence of cartilaginous notochord, at least in the early embryonic life. So after the organism is born, and as the organism grows and develops, there is the notochord, it disappears. Okay, in some cases. So at least in the stage of early embryonic life, there is a presence of cartilaginous notochord. There is also presence of gill slits, and there is a presence of hollow and dorsal nerve cord running through the length of the body and the ventral heart. There is also a presence of ventral heart. Now, phylum Chordata, it is further divided into three subphyla: Urochordata, Cephalochordata, and Vertebrata. So let us now study about each of these subphyla. The first subphylum is Urochordata. And this Urochordata is also called as Tunicata. Okay, and the examples that are put under this subphylum is Herdmania, Salpa, and Doliolum. So this is Herdmania, this is Salpa, and this is Dolulum. Now this subphylum, the organisms that are included in this subphylum, they are called as tunicates, or they are also known as ascidians. Okay, and they are exclusively marine. That means they are only found in marine water bodies. The body is soft and it is covered with a tunic which is made up of tunicin. Okay, it is a covering, the epidermal covering which is present on these organisms. The notochord, it is present only in the tail region. Okay, so only in the tail region of the larva, the notochord is present, and hence the name is being given as urochordata. And as the organism grows, that means as there is metamorphosis that takes place in an organism. Now what is metamorphosis? I have explained it in the previous sessions, that it is a process that during the life stage, or you can say at half of the life stage, there is certain development and there is certain changes that happens in the body of an organism. It grows and it develops. So notochord, it is present in the tail of the larva. Okay, and as the organism grows and as the organism is developing, the notochord is lost. Circulation over here is a closed circulatory system. Okay, so there is no open circulatory system. It is a complete closed circulatory system. The next subphylum is Cephalochordata, and the example is Branchiostoma, okay, which is also known as Amphioxus or Lancelet. So this is Amphioxus or Lancelet. Now again, this is exclusively marine, and it is also called as Lancelet. It is a small fish that does not grow, you can say it does not, the length of the fish, it does not exceed more than 5 centimeters. Then lancelets are partially, they live buried into the soft marine sediments. As you can see over here also, it is very near to the marine sediments. The notochord, it will extend from the, you can say it will extend throughout the body of this organism. So now what is notochord? This is a notochord. There is this presence of notochord. Okay, it is a rod-like structure, cartilaginous structure that is present in some of these organisms. So lancelet, they are partially buried into the soft marine sediments, and notochord, it extends throughout the length of the body of these organisms. Myotome, that are the muscle blocks, these are present in these organisms, and the post anal tail is present. The circulation is a closed type of a circulation, and the blood is without any pigment. So if there is no pigment, there won't be any color of the blood. Okay, the third subphylum is Vertebrata, and these are the chordates. Notochord is replaced by cartilages or bony vertebral column. So here there is no notochord, there is a proper cartilaginous or bony vertebral column. Now subphylum Vertebrata, it is again divided into two divisions. Okay, and the two divisions are Agnatostomata, that is the organism with no jaw, there are jawless organisms, and Natostomata, where the jaws are present. So let us now study about these two divisions. The first division is Agnathostomata, and this division, it includes the lowest or the most primitive vertebrates. You can say the organisms into this division are the most primitive vertebrates, and they are without jaws. So as you can see in this picture also, that there are no jaws. And now this particular division, they include only one class of the living vertebrates, that is Cyclostomata. So Cyclostomata, cyclos means circular and stom means mouth. So as you can see, the organisms are having a round or a circular mouth. So that is how they are put under this class. The example is Petromyzon and Myxing. So this is Petromyzon and this is Myxing, or the hagfish. Now the cyclostomes, they are jawless, as I told you, and they appear like eel. So if you have seen an aquatic organism that is called as eel, which is very common, they very much appear like an eel. The skin is soft, it is smooth, and it contains unicellular mucous glands, but they have no scales. So it is very clear from the pictures over here that the skin of these organisms, it is having no scales. Then there is this median fin that is present, but paired fins are absent. So if you can see that there is a presence of this median fins, but the paired fins, that is the pectoral and the pelvic fins, are absent. Then the animals that suck. Okay, so they have sucking circular mouth without any jaw. The digestive system, they have a good digestive system where there is an anal part and the mouth part, but into this digestive system there is no stomach. Okay, so the alimentary canal, it will not have the stomach. Then the respiration, it occurs through the gills. Okay, so there are gill slits present. Again, the gill slits are without the operculum. Operculum are the coverings that you will see on the gills of the fishes. So over here there is no presence of operculum, but there are gill slits which are present, which are completely open, and there are about 6 to 15 gill slits. Now here you can very well see the gill slits. So this particular organism, that is Petromyzon, is having 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 gill slits. So the gill slits range from 6 to 15. Now talking about the heart, the circulatory system, the heart is two chambered. Okay, so there is one auricle and one ventricle. So that is how the heart becomes two chambered. So this was about the division Agnostomata, where they include one class, that is Cyclostoma. Then the second division is Nathostomata, and here it is divided into two super classes. Okay, so the two super classes are Pisces and Tetrapoda. Now Pisces, they include the organisms that bear fins, and Tetrapoda are the organisms that bear four limbs. Tetra means four, and poda means limbs. The word poda is being denoted for limbs. So that is how four limb animals. Let us start with the first superclass, that is Pisces. These are aquatic animals, and they are poikilothermic. What do you mean by poikilothermic? That means the body temperature of these organisms, it keeps on changing, and it depends upon the surrounding temperature. So it keeps on changing according to the surrounding temperature. Okay, now there is locomotion in these organisms. It takes place by the body muscles or the fins. There is a presence of caudal fins, which you can see very well over here. This is called as the caudal fin, and caudal fin acts as a steering wheel so that they can swim freely into the water. Exoskeleton is of dermal scales. So if you have seen a fish very closely, you will see that the exoskeleton, that is the outer dermis layer or the outer layer, it is with dermal scale. And the endoskeleton is either bony in some of the fishes, or it is cartilaginous. Okay, the body is streamlined, that means it is a boat shaped, and this boat shaped body or the streamlined body, it offers a minimum resistance during swimming, so it is easier for them to swim through the water. Respiration, as you know, that it is with the gills, and over here the heart of the fishes, which is also called as a venous heart. It is again a two-chambered heart, where the heart is ventral in position. So this is the heart, and it is called a venous heart because, as you can see, that the heart of fishes, it is always showing deoxygenated blood. So it is never filled with the oxygenated blood. It is always filled with deoxygenated blood. And so the fish heart is called as venous heart also. They have well-developed brain and large olfactory lobes, and the sexes are separate. Most of the fishes are oviparous, that means they lay eggs, and some of them are viviparous, that means they give birth to their young ones directly. So it depends. Then this superclass Pisces, it is divided into two further classes. The first one is Chondrictis, we'll see the second one also. The first one is Chondrictis, where the example is Scoliodon, that is the dogfish. This is dogfish. Then there is Rhystis, which is sawfish. This is sawfish, where you can see the mouth, it looks like a saw. that you must have seen the carpenters using. So this is a sawfish. Then there is electric ray fish, common stake, the hammerhead fish, the hammerhead shark. Okay, so these are the fishes which are being put under this class Chondrichthys. Now Chondrichthys, it includes the animals which in which the endoskeleton is cartilaginous. Okay, so they do not have bony endoskeleton, but it is cartilaginous, and they are exclusively marine animals. The exoskeleton is in the form of scales, and the teeth are modified, the scales that are present, it is backwardly directed. Okay, so the scales are backwardly directed, and the mouth is ventral in position. Now, two pairs of lateral fins, that is the pectoral and the pelvic fin. This is the pectoral fins are over here, and this is the pelvic fin. Okay, this is present. Then also there is a presence of caudal fin, which is asymmetrical. The term given for asymmetrical is heterocercal. So the fins are asymmetrical. The caudal fin is asymmetrical. Then again, there is a presence of gill slits, which are 5 to 7 in pairs. So if you see over here into this dogfish, this image, you will very clearly see the gill slits. So here there are 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. 5 gill slits at this side and 5 gill slits on the other side. So that is how you can say that there are about 5 to 7 pairs of gill slits which are present, and they are not covered by operculum. So again, there is no covering. It is open. The gill slits are open. Then the air bladder is absent. Okay, now air bladder in these organisms are absent, and so they always have to swim. They constantly have to swim so that they do not sink down. Okay, and these fishes, they are considered to be predatory fish. Now what do you mean by predatory fish? Predatory fishes are the ones that prey on other fishes. Okay, other small fishes. So they are known as predatory fishes. Now the two very common and the famous prey fishes amongst them are the torpedo, that is the electric ray, and some of them have a poison sting, for example trigon, that is the stingray. So this is torpedo, which is very famous for releasing the electric ray for their as they are the predatory fish. And then this one is the stinging ray, which stings and releases poison. Okay, so they use this particular mechanism for both offense and defense. Then the male copulatory organ is called as a clasper, and which are present, and the fertilization is internal. Many of them are viviparous amongst them. Viviparous means that means they give birth to their young ones directly. They do not lay eggs. Okay. Next class is Osteichthys. The examples over here is Bombay duck, then there is lungfish, then there is Exocutus, Hippocalmus, Pomfret, and Labiorohita. Okay, so these are the ones. This is Bombay duck. Okay, then this is flying fish. Then this is the hippocampus is the seahorse, where the picture I have put over here. This is the seahorse, and this is pomfret and labiorohita, and this is the lungfish. Okay, now this particular class, it includes fishes in which they show bony endoskeleton, and hence they are also called as bony fishes. These are aquatic, present in both fresh and marine water. Okay, these fishes are present both in fresh and marine water. Mouth is mostly terminal. So you will see that the mouth is terminal, where in this case the mouth was ventral in position. Okay, then there are 4 pairs of gills which are present. So 2 on either side. So 4 pairs of gills which are present, covered with operculum. So you will see that there is a presence of operculum. So if this is the gill, this upper part that is covering the gill is the operculum. Now air bladder is again present in these fishes, again it maintains a buoyancy, and they can float or they can swim in the water very easily. claspers are absent. Claspers are the male copulatory part, the male reproductive part also you can call it as. So these are absent in these fishes, and the fertilization is external because they are oviparous. That means they lay eggs. Okay, so the fertilization that takes place is external. Then we'll come to the next super class. So if you remember, we had studied about Gnathostomata, which is further divided into two super class. One was Pisces and the other was one was Tetrapoda. So we have just finished with Pisces, where we studied two classes, and now we are studying about Tetrapoda. So Tetrapoda, as I told you, tetra means four and poda is for limbs. So the organisms which bear four limbs are considered to be in this class Tetrapoda. Now these organisms or the animals, it bears two pairs of appendages. So okay, so two pairs of appendages, that means four. Some animals like snakes are secondarily limbless, and the superclass Tetrapoda, it includes four classes: amphibia, reptilia, aves and mammalia. So let us now study about each of these four superclasses. The first one is amphibia. Amphi means both and bias means life. So amphibians are the organisms that live both in water and as well as on land. Okay, so that is how both life. The examples are rana, which is the frog, then buffo, which is toad, salamandra, that is salamander, this is salamander, then there is hyla, that is tree frog, and the limbless amphibians. Now amphibia, it includes the animals which live, as I told you, it lives on land as well as in water, but in fresh water only. They are not found in marine water. They are again poikilothermic, that means their body temperature, it changes according to the surrounding temperature. So the body temperature depends upon the surrounding they are living in. If they are on land or if they are in water, whatever the temperature is, according to that the body temperature changes. The body is differentiated into the head and the trunk. There is neck that is absent, and there is tail in some of the organisms. Tail is actually usually absent, but in some organisms, few exceptions, it is present. As you can see, in salamander there is a presence of this tail. So in some exceptional cases, tail is present, otherwise the tail is also absent. The locomotion is by the two paired limbs that arises from the pectoral and the pelvic girdle, which helps in locomotion for them. And the skin, if you can see, it is very well visible that the skin is moist, it is glandular with mucous glands. Exoskeleton as such is absent, and the eyelids are present. Okay, then the excretory product, the digestive waste and the gametes, are released through a common chamber. So there is a common chamber for all the outlets, the excretory product, the digestive waste as well as the gamete, and the chamber is called as cloaca. Okay, the circulatory system is of closed type, and the heart is three-chambered. Okay, now heart is three-chambered and ventral in position. RBC is biconvex and nucleated. Respiration is by skin, lungs and bucopharynx, and the nervous system is again well developed over here. Sexes are separate and they are oviparous. Oviparous means they lay eggs. Fertilization is therefore external. Development is indirect through aquatic larval stage. That means they show metamorphosis again. So if you, the common example for this I can take as a frog. So a frog, it develops through a tadpole. Okay, so in early stage, it is a tadpole that swims into the water, and then that tadpole, it undergoes metamorphosis, that is certain changes in the body, and it grows into an adult frog. Okay, so this is metamorphosis. Next class is reptilia. Okay, reptilia is come up from a word repure, that means to creep or to crawl. The examples over here is Naja Naja, which is the scientific name for cobra. Then there is Hemidactylus, that is the wall lizard. Then turtle, crocodile, tortoise, tree lizard, that is the chameleon. crate and the wiper. So this is crate and this is wiper. Okay, now as the name says, reptilia, they include crawling animals that crawl upon. Few of them are aquatic or semi-aquatic, and they are also found in marshy areas. The locomotion occurs by limbs in some of these organisms, and the limbs are pentadactyle. Now what do you mean by pentadactyle? That means the digits that are present, the clawed digits that are present, are 5 in number. So if you can see very easily over here in this wall lizard, in this picture, if you count, each limb will have 5 digits. So that is how it makes up to pentadactyle digits. The limbs, they help these animals to walk or to creep. And in case of snakes, the snakes are limbless. That means they crawl, and they crawl on their belly. Reptiles are again poikilotherms. That means their body temperature, it depends on the temperature in their surrounding. The skin is dry, it is non-glandular, and it is covered by exoskeleton of epidermals. Either there is epidermal scales, either there is scutes. Scutes are the bony exoskeleton that you will see in case of crocodiles. So those are scutes. Then either there are shields or plates. Now lizards and snakes, they shed their skin periodically, and the heart has two complete auricles, but the ventricle is incompletely partitioned. That means there is an incomplete partition between the ventricles. So the heart is not completely four-chambered, except for the crocodile. So in crocodile, it is a complete four-chambered heart. Other than that, most of the other reptilia, they have an imperfect four-chambered heart, where the auricles are two, but the ventricles, which are two, are not properly partitioned. Then the sexes are separate, and they show prominent sexual dimorphism. Okay, fertilization is internal, so they are oviparous, except for vipers. So except for vipers, others are oviparous. So viper, it is viviparous, and they show a good parental care. The next one is aves, and this includes birds. So avis means bird, and so this class, it will include birds. Examples are columba, that is pigeon, cetacula, parrot. Then there is shrutio, that is ostrich, kiwi, aptenoditis, that is penguin, corvus, that is crow, neophron, vulture, and passer, that is sparrow. Now the forelimbs are modified into wings over here, okay, which helps them for flying. And most of the birds, they have lost the capacity to fly. For example, some of the birds, they have lost their capacity to fly. For that, in case ostrich, so ostrich, they have lost their capacity or the capability to fly. The hind limbs are usually functioning for walking, clasping the tree branches, or in running also in some cases. Now there are aquatic birds also present, like ducks. So the ducks have webs between their toes that actually helps them to swim. The body is streamlined, that is boat shaped, that again reduces the resistance during their flight. So when they are flying, it helps them in flying easily. It reduces their resistance. Now these are homeotherms. That means their body temperature remains constant, and it does not depend on the body on the temperature that is in their surrounding. Exoskeleton is made up of feather. Scales are present on the hind limbs. So only the hind limbs are having scales, whereas the other parts of the body, it is covered by an exoskeleton in the form of feathers. Then the body is differentiated into proper head, neck, trunk, and the tail region. The skin is thin, it is dry and non-glandular, but there is a presence of this small oil gland, which is also known as uropygial gland, which is present at the tip or the base of their tongue. So So it is present at the base of their tail, somewhere over here at the bottom. Jaws are without the teeth, and it is modified into beak. Now, the blood is red in color due to the presence of red blood cells. The RBCs are biconvex and nucleated. So, the heart is a perfectly four-chambered heart and they show double circulation. Sexes are separate with prominent sexual dimorphism. That means if the male and the female are easily differentiated. And these are oviparous. So, the fertilization is internal. Oviparous means they lay eggs. They do not give birth to their young ones directly. Parental care is very well developed in the case of aves. And there are also seasonal migration that is seen in some of the birds. Like the example I can give you as the flamingo birds. Okay, so flamingo birds, they show this seasonal migration. Now the last one is the class Mammalia. And the examples for this is bat, ratus, that is rat, macaca, which is monkey, camelus, that is camel, whale, human beings, canis, which is dog, felis is cat, elephas, elephant, horse, and pteropus, that is flying fox. Now over here, mammals can be oviparous or they can be viviparous. So the example of oviparous animal is platypus. And viviparous is macropus, that is kangaroo. Mammalia, they include the animals having mammary gland. Mammary glands are the glands which produce milk. So the milk producing glands which are present for the nourishment of the young ones are present in this particular in the animals which are included in this particular class. They are omnipresent, that means they are present everywhere. Most of them are terrestrial, some of them are aquatic, and few like monkeys and bats, they are aerial and arboreal. Limbs are the organs for locomotion, which is used by them for walking, for flying, for climbing, burrowing, swimming, etc. The body is differentiated into a proper head, neck, trunk, and the tail region, and again they are homeotherms, that means their body temperature remains constant despite of the body of the temperature that is there in their surrounding. Exoskeleton is in the form of either hair or they have fur, nails and horns and etc. Skin is glandular, which are they show the presence of sweat glands and the sebaceous gland. Sebaceous glands are the oil glands which are present. Also the mammary glands and are modified sweat glands. Now they have external ear, that is the pinna, which you can very well see in bats. You can see it in all the organisms, that they have the ear pinna, that is the external ear. And they show heterodont dentition. Okay, so they show heterodont dentition, that you can see here in this image of a monkey. RBC is biconcave and unucleated. Blood is red in color, heart is ventral in position, and it is four chambered. Respiration, it takes place by lungs, and the brain is very well developed. So the cerebrum, it shows a transverse band called corpus callosum. And few mammals, they are oviparous, for example duck, wild platypus, that means oviparous again means they lay eggs. Some of them have pouches for the development of their immature young ones. For in that case, you can take an example of kangaroo, and this pouch is known as marsupials. So the pouches which are present in the case of kangaroos are called as marsupials, and majority of them are viviparous. That means they give birth to their young ones directly. So students, with this we complete this chapter. And in the next session, we are going to start with a new chapter, that is the fifth chapter, that is cell structure and organization.